This is TV Podcast Industries, and we're talking about Shogun, Chapter 3, Tomorrow is Tomorrow.
My lord is famous for his trickery. When he was 6 years old, his father traded him to a rival Bushor. As a hostage, he learned one truth. That enemies are everywhere and friends nowhere. To show your true heart is to risk your life.
What happens if he's found?
He will be killed. And all of us.
Welcome back, fellow warriors, to TV Podcast Industries. We're here talking about Chapter 3 of Shogun. Tomorrow is tomorrow. I am one of your hosts, John.
I'm one of your other hosts, Derek.
Welcome back, Derek, to our third installment of, I guess, the Shogun podcast on TV Podcast Industries. After doing the first two episodes, which all came out on the first day, we'll now be going into our weekly rhythms of Shogun.
Yes, absolutely.
For this 10 chapter series.
Absolutely. You know what? I'm really excited to hear some of the feedback and some of the thoughts of our fellow warriors on Shogun.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've been very lucky to been able to see these episodes before anybody else, really. We've been able to get previews for the first 8 episodes, and we've been really excited about it because this feels, as we said in last episode, this feels like something brand new, but I have no idea what the reaction is going to be of our listeners. I know loads of people were excited about it. Loads of people have read the book. It's a very, very famous book, but really have no idea. You know, the epic scale of the show again is something that we haven't seen in such a long time, so I'm excited to hear what everybody has to say about it.
I mean, I think at the moment, for me anyway, I could just kind of absorb this stuff. I mean, it's interesting that we've just watched an animated series in Blue-Eyed Samurai, like we've mentioned previously, effectively around the same kind of ideas, same kind of time period.
Similar time period, yeah.
Yeah, and I could just take more of it. I mean, it feels to me as much a history as well as a cultural lesson. I mean, it's really, really interesting. It's really, really epic. You know, it really kind of sheds a light on sort of, you know, boundaries that are continually smashed. You know, you think of first cultures sort of meeting one another. Where did they come in peace? Did they come in sort of with war as their aim?
Was it conquest?
Yeah, territorial. Was it conquest? You know, but you know, all this period of different cultures being met by other cultures. I guess in this instance, you know, sad as it is to say, it is the West that is this kind of domineering culture. Certainly that's what happened in sort of North and Southern Americas.
Yes.
And again, the same intentions to do this in the East, in Asia. And, it, you know, it's just really interesting that they came up against a culture that was somehow able to resist.
Well, absolutely. Just indomitable culture, you know, I think.
In a sense.
More of the challenge and more of the story that we're going to get throughout Shogun is about the civil wars that were going on during this period of Japan. Yeah. And maybe that's an opening for the West to be able to come in and take what they want out of that culture, out of that society, take the things that they want back to the West. Or maybe they'll be able to form up against the West and not be overtaken. So we obviously, you know, we understand the history of Japan overall, but this time period is a very tumultuous one, and you know, there's lots going on even within Japan, and kind of the way in that we see here is through the eyes of John at times. But what I'm really enjoying about this show is we're not being handheld through everything that's going on between this nation. You know, we're not having, you know, a translator coming along and just telling us what the impact on that person is. We're seeing it a little bit through John's eyes, but a lot of times we're spending time with the Japanese people, with these you know, many factions, let's say, over the course of the story and fact that seeing their story.
Yeah, and the fact that it's subtitled is perfect. Uh-huh. I mean, it absolutely adds that sense of authenticity because, I mean, you know, we do have to be mindful that it is a novel about Japan, about the West's influence and insertion into Japan by a, you know, an Australian-born British writer, as he later came to be, you know, screenwriter and so on. And so, as I say, it's a book I always remember from my parents' bookshelves. Never read it because it looked so massive, and I was put off by it. And I've never gotten around to it. So I'm really intrigued with this adaptation of it because it feels really good. And, you know, if it's faithful to the book or if they're making... or if there are, you know, big or major changes from the book, I would be interested to know because so far I'm really enjoying this adaptation of the material of James Clavell.
Absolutely. You know, it's been really interesting seeing some of the press material coming out. And, you know, as I say, we've seen a lot of the episodes now, but as people are seeing, you know, the names of characters have been marginally changed from the book, maybe to define them a bit better from other characters, or seeing the costumes on screen for the first time and seeing fans of the book and fans of the 1980 Shogun series, hearing their comments about them. It's interesting to get their take on how they find the show when it eventually does come out and they can see the episodes for themselves. So hopefully later on in our feedback section, we'll have some feedback in from our fellow warriors. But of course, if you haven't subscribed to our podcast, we have been podcasting for 10 years this month, I think, as we're releasing this episode. But if you haven't subscribed yet, you can subscribe over on tvpodcastindustries.com. But as I said, we do want to hear your feedback, so you can email us at any time on any of the shows that we're covering to feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com.
Yes. Or you can, of course, come on over to our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/TV Podcast Industries, where we'll have a spoiler post for each and every episode of this season of Shogun. I mean, interestingly as well, you know, James Clavell wrote this sort of epic Asiatic series, so not just Shogun, but a load of other novels in the same form and connected. So, you know, a huge amount of material here. So you just wonder, you know, if there's more to come.
Well, absolutely.
Depending on ratings, I guess, and all the other stuff that needs to be proven before things sort of enter off into multiple seasons.
Exactly. I'm hoping it's a big success given what we've seen so far. Yeah,
definitely. But let us get into our spoiler-filled discussion of Chapter 3 of Shogun. Tomorrow is tomorrow. Derek, who gave us what, where, when, how, and why?
Well, as you mentioned, James Clavell is the writer of the original 1975 novel that this show is based on. This episode was written by Shannon Goss. She was actually an executive producer on The Walking Dead, Daryl Dixon, last year and wrote episode 4 of that series, La Dame de Fer.
Interesting.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the Daryl Dixon Walking Dead shows.
It was great.
Very different.
Yeah, I kind of enjoyed that after sort of, dare I say it, migrating away, at least in my mind, from The Walking Dead series.
Yeah, I think you watched every single episode with me, but you were kind of watching it on your phone for The Walking Dead. But Daryl Dixon, it was a very different show. Again, it was kind of exploring French culture at times throughout that show. Not in the same way, of course, as Shogun, but interesting, I suppose, after spending so many years walking around the Georgia area with The Walking Dead, it felt like something very different.
Yeah, absolutely.
So great to have Shannon over here for Shogun.
Yeah, definitely.
The director of the episode is Charlotte Brandstrom. We've talked about Charlotte many times on the podcast. Yeah, she directed two episodes of The Witcher Season 1 and directed the two highest rated episodes of The Rings of Power, Episode 6, Udun, and Episode 7, The Eye, which I'm really, really happy to say those are just two excellent episodes of TV on Prime Video. Really, really good. And she'll be back to direct the first episode of the second season of Rings of Power, which we're hoping to get to see sometime this year, potentially.
Excellent stuff. Yeah, I mean, it's amazing, isn't it? Really, sort of all this intertwining of really good directors on TV doing, you know, I mean, you can see, you know, as we said for the first two episodes, you know, this has a real epic feel.
Yeah.
So did The Rings of Power. So does The Witcher. I mean, it's world building, which, you know, this needs to be, because it's building the world of Japan being visited for the first time ever by, you know, the main protagonist in John Blackthorne. So, you know, it's really important. It's really interesting that they pick someone who has had to build the world of these fantasy epics well. And you can see that connective tissue. You can see the idea of those transferable skills.
Absolutely.
How to do that. You know, what's important for it? What do they need to show that really gets to the crux of it? And I think, you know, this is what you get here with the Shogun.
Well, absolutely. Yeah, just great to see Charlotte and Bowart here. But if we do ever get to interview Charlotte about all the work that she's done, John, please don't ask her a question about her transferable skills. It will seem like a different type of interview
than
the interviews we usually do.
You know what I mean?
I do, absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. You know, director is directing all the different units of production. You know, throughout, you know, as well as the artistic and so on. So
absolutely,
you know, it is about multitasking, transferable skills, however dull and boring that may sound.
It just sounds like you're trying to interview her in a different way for a job. That's all. Great stuff. John, do you want to tell us what they gave us with your quick synopsis for Shogun Chapter 3, Tomorrow is Tomorrow?
Sure. After John Blackthorne survives a brazen assassination attempt, Toranaga realizes he must ferry his allies out of Osaka or risk certain defeat.
Ooh, the escape episode.
It is, but it's an escape episode that I really, really enjoyed because it is kind of, you're damned if you stay and you're damned if you go.
Absolutely.
So you might as well go because at least you've got more chance of surviving once you've gone and you're in your own heartlands and, you know, area of power and influence. But, you know, staying behind in Osaka, it is kind of, you know, like the pig being reared and fattened for slaughter. Like, there's nothing you can do.
You're just waiting for the axe to fall.
Exactly.
Yeah. Kind of what, you know, what John heard last week from Rodriguez, you know, the plans are theirs, the games are theirs, and you can't do anything at all. This is kind of the feeling that Toranaga has here. If he stays, he has no way of controlling his fate.
Yeah.
If he leaves, but there's a potential opportunity here for him. And yeah, danger at every turn throughout this episode.
Exactly. And I think, you know, on the face of it, a very simple episode of one of escape from Osaka. Underneath this is there are different levels of appreciation beginning to develop in both senses from John Blackthorne and, or, you know, from the barbarian to the savage, you know, that kind of idea. But also equally, you know, there is an appreciation of this kind of savage of John Blackthorne and his courage, or at least his actions in the face of adversity. So, you know, kind of it's building a bedrock or foundations of something between, you know, these two intrinsic protagonists of this epic. So I really like that. But shall we get into our top Bushidos of the episode?
Absolutely. Let's go into the kind of opening escape. The Bushido one is Escape from Osaka.
Yes.
And it's a very interesting opening because we talk about the assassination attempt from the previous week, that it was the Society of the Amida, which are a very well-known society in this era, a group of people that always get their target. We hear from Mariko when she's explaining to John who the assassins were, that this person was someone that was part of the court for many, many years and almost activated to kill John. She was there to be in a position where if they needed her, she would perform the assassination, and only failed because of the exchange of John from his room by Toranaga.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the other interesting thing here with this escape from Osaka, I really like the intro of this episode with Toranaga and Yabushiga. You know, and talking about these assassins, the Society of Amida, as you say, and, you know, the talk of betrayal, and what did Ishido offer to him, you know, and did it interest you? You know, what is your price? All these kind of words coming from Toranaga to Yabushiga. It's like, I think you know, you get this sense here, Toranaga, this is almost like the purest form of better the devil you know than I've seen in a show for quite a long time.
Mm-hmm.
In that, I think Toranaga absolutely understands that Yabushige is wholly ambitious, mm-hmm. and it is the pathway to that ambition that will dictate his decisions.
Well, yes.
And at the same time, he's clever enough to not necessarily be constrained by protocols and so on. But, you know, he's willing to weigh up the probabilities and to play both sides.
Yeah.
So, you know, in a sense, I actually wonder whether Toranaga sees a bit of himself in Yabushige.
Oh, yeah.
Because we have a great line from Toranaga to his son later on in the episode, which I feel is exactly the philosophy of Toranaga. And I think that's Yabushige's as well. You know, Toranaga says, "You're playing a game of friends and enemies when in this life you only have yourself."
Absolutely.
And I think that is exactly Yabushige as well.
Yeah, yeah, totally agree. You know, we often talk about Game of Thrones, even though we didn't cover it in the podcast. And part of the reason why Game of Thrones is so well loved and is such an example of great television is because it was one of the first shows that properly brought to screen this ability to see characters trying to use everything around them to play the game right, to get themselves in the best position. Game of Thrones was not the first book to do that by any means. No. There are hundreds of examples of that. There's hundreds of examples of TV shows that have attempted to do characters who are trying to navigate themselves through really difficult situations. And I do think that Yabushige is that type of character. He's basically trying to see a few steps ahead. If Toranaga loses his head at the hands of Bushido, which is very likely at this moment, and he has declared himself as Bannerman, for want of a better word, for Toranaga, then he's left with no other options.
Exactly.
If he starts to play the game right, he could put himself in a prime position for an even better place within the new world after the death of Toranaga.
Exactly.
That's kind of where he's positioning himself. So Toranaga understands that. Toranaga understands that he has to make the plan to keep himself alive, but he won't complain too much about somebody else making other plans in case something happens, but he wants to keep his people on side because they also get him out of things.
Yeah. He does think he's going to lose his head. He feels he's being brought up there to be killed, executed for that betrayal. You know, you even see Hiramatsu sort of slightly unclip his sword. You know, he says, "Are you going to take my head?" And in the end, Toranaga is like, you know, "Watch the sun rise with me."
Yes.
You know, and he says, "I need to get the Anjin and Lady Kiri out of Osaka to your village, one of the villages in your fief."
Yes,
in Ajiro. Mm-hmm. So, what do you want for that to happen? You know, if you didn't take up Ishida's offer to replace him on the Council of Regents, he says, "Well, what is your price?"
Mm-hmm.
You know, and a really clever thing in that, okay, so you've been offered 100, here's 100. Well, I'm going to ask you, what actually do you want?
Exactly.
Grant, you can get Suruga Province to expand the boundaries of your fief and become more powerful if you do this for me.
If you get us out.
He agrees to do it because he's playing both sides of, you know, he's in the middle here.
Yes.
He's still playing both sides. And I just really like this, you know, in terms of setting up this escape from Osaka between these two men, because I think that it's really, I think they're kind of the same side of the same coin almost.
Well, I think anybody that's successful in these types of situations are similar. It's not even playing both sides, because that would infer playing both sides against each other. It's trying to play the game to the best benefit of yourself, effectively.
Exactly.
And I do like the kind of running joke about Yabushige and his, I guess, his nervousness that he may lose his head at any time. It opens, the entire episode opens with him writing his will, and he's talking to his aide, his advisor that we've seen throughout the series, saying to him, I think this is the best one we've written so far. And then later on, when they're going into another very dangerous situation, he actually says, no, I don't think I need to write another will. I think I'm okay in this situation. So he does genuinely think, potentially at any time, he could be losing his head. So so I do like that little running joke.
No, absolutely.
A bit of gallows humor.
Yeah, exactly. And I think what, you know, this escape from Osaka as well, I love the fact that there's an element of deception here, both to Yabushiga, despite that deal being done. Yabushiga is unaware of the switcheroo of the human cargo here, in that, yes, everyone knows the engine is going, but they all think, including Ishido, thinks it's Lady Kiri. What I love about this is that the switcheroo where Toranaga replaces Lady Kiri in the carriage, then it becomes quite clear that he has only told the women in his life that remain in his life. There's the distraction of the lady who's pregnant. There's Lady Kiri in and of herself, you know, and no one else knows about this.
Exactly.
Until the surprise attack on the road. And it's like, it's just all really good. I love this.
But John does, of course, see it. So John Blackthorne, he becomes aware of it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which I do really like. But you know, you are right in the synopsis that we've seen. You know, it's Toranaga realizing that he has to take all of his allies out of Osaka because potentially, you know, he could lose one of them. One of them could be taken out as punishment almost for what he's done, for him actually leaving. So we have Fuji being told by Hiramatsu that she must go after her husband and her child have died, that this is the way to honor honor their loss is to go and work alongside Toranaga. So she's going to go out with him. And then we have Mariko being told by her husband Botaro that she has to go to the fishing village. She must leave now. She has the role.
Yeah.
She has to go. He seems very unhappy about the situation, but he is under orders to bring his wife and take her along with the Anjin to Anjira.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, it's almost the full court going out. It's just Hiramatsu and then Lady Kiri, who remains behind quietly.
I do like that Lady Kiri got a little dig in, though. Yeah. She was able to say the reason she's leaving is because there's just too many assassins around here.
Yeah, exactly.
I really like that.
It was really good. So, and again, the tension this builds up when there is the switcheroo and you have Ishido and his kind of main general, Yozen, and then also as they're leaving then Osaka, you have, you know, you've got the red tape of just the, you know, the sentries on duty and the gatekeeper, I guess.
Yeah.
Who is like, no, we need to verify it, even though it's just been verified by Ishido and his main general is there escorting them.
Yeah.
Which it means John has to intervene in order to keep Toranaga's presence a secret for everyone.
I have to say, I really like this. I like John using his aggressive sound and his noise and his build to make it look like he's really angry about the treatment of the women within this group and how could they possibly do that, knowing that they can't understand the words he's saying, but he'll be able to get across how angry he is and the barbarian in him kind of coming out, and Mariko trying to talk them down enough to distract them from going to check this particular container that actually has Toranaga inside it.
Yeah, his
just long enough.
Yeah, exactly. It's his theatrics, the distraction of it.
Yeah,
and it's interesting because we hear a bit later about Toranaga as a boy being put as a ransom with a competing family where, you know, when he was a kid.
Yeah.
Him understanding,
almost like a hostage,
sort of the different approaches to warfare, almost like the, you know, the game of spies as well as the game of war, mm-hmm. and the game of diplomacy and politics. Like, he comes across as a very rounded sort of individual that Absolutely. Will use the appropriate kind of tactic at the right time. So this is really kind of, I just thought was really, really good.
Absolutely. Yeah. Let's go on to a quick one for Bushido number two, the attack on the road.
Yeah, I mean, well, this is where it all gets revealed in a sense, mm-hmm. with the, again, another attack on this convoy in order to kill the heretical Christian, mm-hmm. in John Blackthorne. And interestingly, again, you see here that Lord Kiama is there at the scene of his dirty work, mm-hmm. for the priests, as he ambushes them in a forest as they make their way to the harbor of Osaka.
Yeah.
And this is, yeah, everything gets revealed here, because there's that moment where he says, are they fighting amongst themselves down there? Are they attacking one another?
Mm.
When suddenly Ishido's men, who is escorting, you know, these honored guests, to the harbor,
mm-hmm.
suddenly realize that it's Toranaga in the carriage,
yep.
not Lady Kiri. You know, we heard earlier, you know, the reason for Ishido being kind of pernickety about this is because for high-level guests, they need a day's notice before they leave,
yes.
and so on. That's all, you know, about control,
mm-hmm.
and knowing where you're friends and enemies are. So I like this, how it all kind of went to pot, really. The game was up, there was identified, you know, because Toranaga is risking everything to leaving Osaka. It is a risk for everyone that is an ally of his. So this I thought was really good, though, because we see Mirako getting involved in the fighting.
Absolutely, yeah.
With some great skills with that kind of spear type weapon.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. I had to take a note of this. The weapon is called the Naginata. They were originally used by samurai, but it is the iconic weapon in Japan of the Onimusha, a female warrior of nobility.
Excellent.
So it would be very accurate to the type of weapon that she'd use. Interestingly, the actress who plays Mariko, Anna Sawai, who we saw in Monarch, the Godzilla show, John, she was talking about the fact that she had to learn how to do all this fighting, and that women during this period would absolutely learn working with these types of weapons, but they always have to keep their legs closed at all times while fighting, as they would at all other times, because that's how they dress, effectively. So that's the reason why they choose these type of longer weapons. That's the reason why they would use them, because you don't have the same reach if you can't open your legs and swing around like another type of fighter. So so interesting touch there in the fight, but very accurate to the period, very accurate to the time. But also, it's great for the... For just as a person watching the show and enjoying the show, it's great that we see Mirako stepping up, and she's the one that saves Toranaga from what could potentially be his carriage going completely on fire and him burning to death inside of it. So she's the one that actually saves him, which is really good, because there's just that tendency when you have that Westerner perspective, you have John Blackthorne here, there's a tendency to have him be the one to save people at all times and nobody else be the owners of their story. So,
yeah, absolutely.
You know, you could have had that. The only instance in this episode where John really saves them, he gives some advice at times, and they take the advice and do things with it, which we'll talk about in one of the other attacks, let's say, later on in the episode. But the only time really is that moment outside of Osaka when he just bellows and yells and gets people to avoid going and taking out Toranaga there, or finding Toranaga there. But the rest of the episode is more a little bit of advice here and there from John as an ally to these people, as opposed to him being the savior that comes in and has to win everything, has to be the one that frees saves everybody at all times.
Yeah, exactly. You know? No, I would agree with that. I mean, it to me, I think John Blackthorne's sort of, I guess, inserting himself into this world and into Toranaga's sort of eye line, really, is because actually he's completely disposable.
Yes.
But at each point, he survives it. Uh-huh. So I think it's that quality of survival that Toranaga is seeing you know?
Absolutely.
But ultimately, you know, we saw Torunaga saying, yes, he can go to prison, when there was potential for conflict, potential for his real plans being exposed to Ishido at his quarters in Osaka.
Yeah.
You know, yes, he can go to prison and almost get executed. Mm-hmm. Or in this case, you know, and we'll come to this with the escape at from the docks, is that he's left behind in Osaka for Torunaga to actually escape from Osaka on the Portuguese black ship.
Exactly. You know, so, and I suppose the point that I'm trying to make here at this time, or as it goes through the rest of the episode, the point I'm trying to make is, if John wasn't here, and the same situation happened, if Torunaga still had to escape from Osaka and still had to make his deal, everything would have still gone down pretty much the way it happened.
Yeah.
John isn't the focus of every time people are saved. Absolutely. Throughout the episode, which would be a tendency of, well, let's say pretty poor writing from a decade or two ago. So I'm glad we're seeing John's story, plus we're seeing Mariko's story, and we're seeing Torunaga's story, and they're all intertwining, as opposed to being, hey, look, it's John Blackthorne saving everybody as he busts his way through Japan.
Exactly,
But finally, on the attack on the road piece, the actual fight itself, I thought was really, really well staged. I loved this idea of seeing the Christian samurais, effectively the samurais working for the Christians, attacking from one side, and then the two rival factions who were supposed to be together, Ishida's army and Yabushiga's army, going at it on the road as well, because it felt like, who am I focusing on here? Who are the people I'm supposed to be focusing on?
It felt like the confusion really of kind of that tight quarter battle. And I think the confusion from Kiami, where it's like, are they attacking one another? Because, you know, with Torunaga's cover being blown, you know, you've got Yabushiga, who's like, feeling there's a betrayal
once
here.
Again,
and there's Yozen, who's having to, you know, realizing that they've been tricked, and he needs to report back the truth of the matter back to Ishido.
Exactly.
So, you know, it's really good. And this battle then, I think, going on to Bushido number 3, you know, continues through as they make their way to the docks in order to escape from Osaka.
Yeah.
But what we hear is that, you know, we have the regent, Kiyama, say that, you know, get the men ready in the harbour. So again, the danger's not over. It's just that the battle has moved to the docks. And, you know, I think of note here is we see, Mirakawa's, husband, Toda Hirakatsu, or Buntaro, as he's kind of affectionately known as, I think, in a sense.
It feels like a title or a.
Yeah. It's,
maybe a nickname.
A title. Yeah.
I don't think he has much affection in them. That's the only reason.
He certainly doesn't give much affection, as we saw when they were leaving Torunaga's quarters.
Exactly.
You know, he feels his son is a wet, I guess, ultimately. But we have him, first of all, sort of slowing down Kiyama's soldiers so that Torunaga and the rest of the group can make it to the docks in order to get on the ships. But we see him left on the docks fighting as a samurai warrior, you know. The, you know, that classic thing that you see where, you know, Torunaga and him from a distance sort of exchanging customs and bows of respect for him, effectively, you know, accepting that he may die in the service of his lord here. And
he's totally willing to, like, that's, you know, that's the honor of his position, the honor of what he's trying to do. He's allowing his lord escape, allowing his wife to escape as well, which is, you know,
there
also
is a really nice moment though, I think, in his eyes where it's the realization that they aren't coming back to get him, or he can't get on a boat.
They can't come back,
whatever it is. And it's quite good because it kind of chimes with John Blackthorne saying, we must go back and get him, you know? And then he sees this kind of devoted sacrifice, you know, this almost ceremonial sacrifice. And it's really interesting. And it also, it kind of harks back to the fact that, you know, Blackthorne has had interest in Buntaro, you know, asking Noriko about her husband, you know, or actually just putting two and two together that he is her husband and so on. And I, you know, I think in that moment it all kind of coalesces really nicely that here's the end of this character as he faces Kiyama's troops.
Exactly. Yeah. What a way to go.
Yeah.
Oof. Yeah. It seems like a proper warrior moment when you see him just on the docks as a few of them come down. And it almost seems like the rest of Kiyama's troops are standing away. It's almost like they're scared of Buntaro because he's such a good warrior and has defeated so many of them.
You know,
there's almost that moment. So he has a rush at them, and that's kind of the last we see of Buntaro as the ships pull out. Again, Mariko being very stoic in this loss of her husband.
Yeah.
John is the one that's screaming. John's the one that's saying we should be going back for him. We can't leave him behind, you know, but realizes again, if they were, he'd be putting everybody else in danger. So,
absolutely.
Yeah, really good.
And then, as you say, you know, the deal here with the captain of the Portuguese black ship. Interestingly, though, this captain really doesn't seem to give two Fs about whether he's allowed to leave or is being given permission to leave by anyone in the Japanese court, let alone Toranaga.
Yes.
It's almost a soldier's response, whereas the priests are the diplomats, where he's like, you know, I work for the crown, not the church.
Oh, well, absolutely.
That we have earlier on.
Yeah.
I'm leaving, otherwise we lose the wind, and I've got however much in the worth of trays in the holds of my ship. So,
because remember, we talked about it last week that Toranaga had already put a block on the black ship, and Toranaga expected that to be respected. That's what happens if he chooses a boat doesn't leave the harbor. The boat doesn't leave the harbor, but this captain is not willing to take that at all. And when Toranaga offers that as his way of safe passage, he says, "Well, your ship can leave." He goes, "No, well, my ship was always going to leave anyway. I want more than that." So he does make a trade with both the captain and also with the priests. He offers the priests the ability to build a church within his homeland.
Yeah,
their
Edo,
first opportunity in Edo.
And also to, you know, he appeals, I guess, to the trader in the captain, where it's, I want, you know, 10,000 worth of investment in the silk trade, and you can have half the profit.
Exactly.
So he's, you know, what I like about Toranaga is he absolutely has a goal, he has an aim, but the means to that is totally fluid. And when told he must leave the sailor, the pilot, John Blackthorne, he says, "Okay, then."
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yep.
"I'm sorry, you're having to be left here." You know, and I kind of really enjoy this deal. And it's not, you know, even the church in Edo is so that the priests can turn Ono and Kiyama against Ishido. Like, that it's the power play within the Council of Regents. It's his own wealth. It's effectively buying the church as well, with the promise of the church in Edo. And I like the response of the priest, in that it seems like the chief priest is like, "Well, we can't do that, you know, that's corrupt," and so on.
But
we'll let, if we pray on it, you know, like, it'll just happen.
Yeah.
But that's because you know it's going to happen because you've made a deal.
Exactly.
It's kind of like that fluffy, "No, we're not corrupt, but if we pray on it and the Lord's guidance tells us to do it, you know, let's reflect on it. Let us convince ourselves that it's the right course of action."
Yeah.
And it's like, it feels like a real sort of, you know, a missionary's purpose to, like, to convert, to bring the locals to the church.
I can kind of see that, but I also see echoes of what we talked about earlier on with Yabushiga. This is another group of very powerful people who need to navigate some quite dangerous waters here.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, you would get that if they really underlined it to the members of the Regent's Council that were allied to them, if they underlined that they didn't want them to go after Toranaga, that they could lose their heads.
Absolutely.
So they need to balance their tactics.
Absolutely.
And even, maintain their power. Yeah,
I mean, even their dealings with the captain, it's like, you know, he's kind of going all like, I'm going to go against Toranaga, I'm just going to leave the port anyway. And it's mm-hmm. like, you know, they're trying to persuade even him, you know, we are here with their permission, with exactly. their grace. It's like, yeah. if we upset them, if we seem to be disrespectful, that grace could be withdrawn.
Exactly.
And, you know, we're goners, mm-hmm. you know? And yeah. so, you know, their diplomatic treading of these, yeah, tough waters, like you're saying.
Yeah. Yeah.
But ultimately, I like the fact that despite John being kind of left high and dry, he mm-hmm. decides to leave being high and dry with a good, you know, F this. I'm not staying here. And, yeah. you know, uses the black ship as cover for the Japanese galley that he takes
yeah.
to escape the Osaka and to run the blockade of Kiyama's men mm-hmm. in the harbor.
Yeah.
So I kind
of... It was John that noticed that. He's the one that kind of went, hang on a second, there's yeah. a very small ships out there.
Yeah,
do people around here fish at night?
Yes,
no,
exactly.
they don't. Okay. So again, that was just a little nod from John. He's not saving everybody, but it is by things that he would notice that he's kind of giving them enough information to start their own plans, I suppose. But yeah, I love that. And again, you know, that echo of Buntaro and what he did to sacrifice himself to save his lord.
Yeah.
That's not John Blackthorne. He's not willing to sacrifice himself. He's going to be in the hands of Ishido if that happens, right? If he's left behind and stays there, he's going to be in the hands of Ishido. He's going to die, most likely, yeah. right? So he's going, not a chance. I'm going to try everything I get out of here. And once again, I love the banter between John and Rodriguez, who've just reunited here, kind of, yeah. as John's on one ship and Rodriguez on the other going, oh my God, that bastard's still alive. How is he making it out of here alive? And kind of giving it a good go, you know, between the two of them. He doesn't believe that John's going to survive very much longer, but he'll give him a little handout, a very small handout. John was good enough to be able to get himself almost around the coastline.
It's the debt repaid.
Exactly.
You know, he says, you know, it like it's all high stakes because effectively Rodriguez is being told by the captain to crash
mm-hmm.
the Japanese ship onto the rocks, to
yeah.
force it onto the rocks. And Rodriguez just allows enough space for that, the ship that John is piloting to sort of creep in front mm-hmm. and to get around the black ship. And, you know, as he whispers, that's my debt repaid
exactly.
for having rescued me.
Saving his life, yeah.
And saving his life. So, you know, he doesn't crash him against the rocks like mm-hmm. it's intended. So this was really good. And I hope Rodriguez pops up again somewhere. But I guess if they're on their way to Macau, mm-hmm. unlikely for the next few episodes, at least.
Well, absolutely, unless we see John down in Macau.
Well,
at some point later in the series.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, he has been such a good part of the show here, Nestor Carbonell. Just once again, just every time he's on screen, you know, even when he learns that John's still alive, when the captain goes in and talks to the priest, he's kind of in awe of the fact that this man who is so brutish and so arrogant and doesn't understand the ways of the Japanese, how he could still be alive after this time.
Yeah, absolutely.
And he's probably right. And this is pretty early on in the story already. So really good. Yeah, I really like this moment, and just really well filmed as well. This battle on the ocean, or this escape on the ocean, I guess. Really good stuff. Let's go on to Bushido number 4.
Yes, impeaching Toranaga. Or not, as the case may be, because again, I think this is another arrow in the quiver of Toranaga
without
in terms of, you know, outmaneuvering his foes. In this case, through pure bureaucracy and administration,
mm-hmm.
in that he has, whilst having tricked them with subterfuge to escape Osaka, and then also rode his luck with deals mm-hmm. With the devil, effectively. Because, I mean, this is the interesting thing. You know, Toranaga, in the last episode, found out that the people he's now making deals with are trying to carve up his home country.
Well, exactly.
You know? So he's kind of, as I say, he's hugely flexible and fluid in the means to the end.
But I'd say what's hugely important to this character, that he takes all of the information and doesn't make rash decisions about it. It's really important to his character, and that's the kind of advice that you were talking about earlier on that he gives to his son.
That is exactly...
He gives to other people around
him. That is exactly right.
It's take all the information in. It may seem like the worst possible information you can have, but take it all in and make a decision on how you go.
It's exactly that. And just to repeat what he says to his son, you are playing a game of friends and enemies when in this life you only have yourself.
Exactly.
You know, so on one sense, the Portuguese are his enemies, but he's not playing them as simply that or as friends. It's his life, his goals, what he wants to do, and they will serve their purpose.
Yeah.
And similarly, you know, he's left his right-hand man in Hiramatsu back at his quarters in Osaka, having tricked all the regents and escaped from Osaka. He asks his right-hand man to face all those lords of the council in order to give them this letter of resignation, which means that the council has one vote less now that is required for a vote to actually take place on this council. So, you know, he's just using these rules against them.
Absolutely. And importantly, they would need five votes to impeach him, and they don't have five votes. Yeah. So traditionally, the way it would work is he votes, obviously, not to impeach, and the other four vote to impeach. That's fine, but they need five votes to carry and pass judgment. So he's effectively gotten himself out of it by
so they need a new regent or to be appointed to the council, which I guess has its own flourish of process and so on. So I kind of I really really enjoyed.
I did think that's the option. Yeah, they do need to find somebody else to sit on the council. Like yes, that's the only way around it. But can they? I don't really know, because
the council
has only been appointed for this purpose, to effectively stand guard until the heir comes of age. So have they got an idea of how they get somebody else on the council? Is there a way to do that? If they don't have five votes to get somebody on the council, can they appoint somebody? So has he just put them in a holding pattern for the moment?
No, maybe. I would think that, you know, if someone's resigned, they would be able to. I mean, I don't know, but I think we saw in the last episode of Shido looking to recruit Yabushigi to be on the council.
Oh, okay. Yep.
You know, we have Taranaga ask what was Shido's offer, and it was to replace him on the council, which he refused to do. You know, maybe those motions were already being done, and I think that's to the point. It's just to delay for... It might only be half an hour or an hour where Shido goes, well, the Taiko is dead, has been dead long ago. Mm. You know, if their aim is ultimately to make sure his heir doesn't get on the throne, do you know what I mean? It ultimately becomes a coup situation, but what are they going to do?
Yeah.
What's the judge of their character? And you can see the frustration because it's now... Right, we've got to go through whatever process it is to make sure that we impeach him. It's been, in effect, delayed some more. And not indefinitely, but for enough time for events to continue to unfold for Taranaga.
I get the feeling that the fact that he's still alive out there and resigned potentially gives another bit of pause there, because, you know, again, this is a structure that is built specifically by the former Taiko to preserve the government or preserve Japan until his heir comes along to take over. So effectively, because Toranaga has walked away, that may instill some dissatisfaction, let's say, in the people of Japan in the situation. So are they? Would they be on the side of Toranaga walking away from this situation, and would it start a civil war if the other four members of the council decide to do something that may not be in the wishes of the Taiko? So there's a whole piece of navigation that this group now need to do, and it feels like Ishido's just about gotten everybody else in this group on side, almost. They're not in control, because as we see at the beginning, before Hiramatsu comes in, they're all fighting about the attack on Toranaga. The fact that there was an assassin that went in to try and kill John Blackthorne, and almost killed Toranaga. That is completely disrespectful. They could have had Toranaga already sentenced, impeached, and killed by now, but because of the attack, it's caused this great rift, caused him to give in his resignation. So so now everything's become even more complicated. Exactly.
Yeah. It gave him enough information, enough to act, to understand that the Christian regents on the council were after the Anjin. Mm-hmm. He had information that was important to him.
Absolutely.
And, you know, I think that's, he's fluid enough to adapt his plans.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And I think that's what's so, so good about him.
Absolutely. So, yeah, that'll be very interesting to see how the machinations play out for the next couple of episodes in Osaka, because it does feel like they have their own decisions to make now with that resignation decision from Toranaga. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. Shall we get on to Bushido number 5?
Yes.
From Anjin to Hatamoto.
Mm-hmm.
John Blackthorne, does he travel? Yes.
Yes, he does. Yeah.
Basically, I think, you know, Toranaga is quite impressed that his pilot, this Anjin, has made it out of Osaka.
Mm-hmm.
When everything was against him doing that.
Absolutely.
So he, in a sense, gets promoted here, but for a reason, for mm-hmm. a good reason. You know, he's named Hatamoto. It's a great honor, but it's so that John Blackthorne can train a regiment that'll be overseen by Yabushige in foreign tactics.
Mm.
I thought that was really, really interesting to see this, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, and importantly, Taranaga's leaving his son behind with John Blackthorne to train this new army.
Yeah, exactly.
That's where the discussion that you've been talking about with between father and son about playing game of friends and enemies. That's where the discussion came from. But yes, it seems like John is starting to kind of go up the ranks. You know, I had to look up what Hatamoto meant. Hatamoto is literally means those who stand under the flag, but the European equivalent of the English equivalent would be a banner man for Toranaga. So effectively, he's agreed to become someone very important to Toranaga.
Holds the banners of the house, you know, mm-hmm. and because, I mean, always with war, it was that, you know, they would be taken as a prize,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
and the banners of other armies and so on. So,
exactly.
yeah, very important. It's defending the honor by holding this and making sure it doesn't go into the hands of their enemies.
Yeah.
So, yeah, really interesting to see that he has been given this title and honor.
Yeah.
I think the other thing that we get here is, you know, talking about the Blackthorne when he was asking Mariko about her husband, and we got some information about his own, that he has two children,
mm-hmm.
And so on. But we have just before this honor, where Mariko is kind of asking John Blackthorne about his family. You know, she's being inquisitive about him, and he mm-hmm. says, you know, it was kind of a lie. She will only be 2 years. I've been away from England for 2 years, you know. Mm. My aim was for the horizon more than the deep, he says, yes. and it was freedom more than the horizon that this endeavor gave me. It was freedom. It was like, you know, he was this adventurer,
exactly.
this explorer, and that was what it was always about. So he hasn't actually ever met his daughter Elizabeth,
yeah.
who he has fathered, despite having said that previously to Mariko.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But he is an opportunist. He will take the opportunity, even though, as he says himself, he doesn't really know much about tactics. He's a pilot, right? So he doesn't really know much about tactics, but he'll take the job because it keeps him alive for a bit longer.
Alive.
Keeps him in the good graces of Toranaga as well.
And he believes he's made a deal where he will get his ship and his men back as well.
Yes, but importantly, Toranaga does show John that he has the journals, has the orders that he had been given by the Portuguese that could condemn John to death. But he's saying, it'll take a long time to translate. probably about as long as it will take to train an army for me. So, so I like that. That's a nice little extra bit of pressure from Toranaga. But John is going to take on the job and is now Hashimoto.
Absolutely. Yeah, good stuff. I think that brings us to an end to this episode. Are there any notes that you have at all, Derek?
Just the only other thing is just that the diving session at the end of the episode between Toranaga and John. You know, it's after he's named him the Bannerman, or named him as Hashimoto. But it seems like there's a growing respect almost between the two of them. You know, he's seen something in John that he wants to learn. And I just thought it was interesting that we had quite a bit of the episode dedicated to that towards the end. You know, this five or six minutes of John diving into the sea, coming back up.
And again.
And then even at that point, Mariko, who generally wouldn't speak her mind to Toranaga, certainly wouldn't go against his orders, kind of saying, can you give John another day? But you learn again from Toranaga, he's a very determined person. He will learn how to dive today, one more dive, and then he'll take a go. And then they race to shore effectively. So I just liked that moment because, again, you're having more character development between the two of them. It's not all about war. It's not all about machinations. It's also a bit about who they are as people as well.
Yes, exactly.
And how they're starting to connect in that way as well. So I thought that was a really good scene. Any other notes, any other points from yourself, John?
No, none from me. I think just in terms of the episode, for me, I would give this 4.5 high dives out of 5.
Nice. You know,
I think in essence, a real simple story of escape, but a lot of relationship building happening here. A lot of trust, a lot of respect, both ways happening here, but still within this bubble of a lot of the members of Toranaga's company seeing John Blackthorne as a barbarian still. But I think Toranaga seeing sort of some qualities there that can be useful to him. And ultimately, is that not what a great leader does?
Exactly.
Is able to identify those people who have qualities that in the service of whatever cause it is beneficial and gets results in some way. And I think he sees that here, that this tenacity, this survival instinct.
Absolutely.
And I think the predicament that we know of Toranaga is one that he needs to survive as well. Mm-hmm. So having all those survivors with him is a useful mindset given what is probably to come.
Without a doubt.
So yeah, 4.5 high dives out of 5 for me.
Great stuff. Yeah, I really enjoyed the episode as well.
Yeah. So let's move on to some feedback.
So it's over to me, Derek, for the feedback. I'm all alone. John's gone away for a couple of weeks. So I'll be here with your feedback each week on Shogun. We'd love to hear your thoughts about each of the episodes. Please keep emailing us in to feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com or pop on over to our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/TV Podcast Industries. There's a spoiler post up there for each episode of Shogun as it comes out. Love to hear your thoughts to keep me company while John's gone away. The feedback overall has been fantastic since the show came out. I think it was at 100% Rotten Tomatoes score at the moment of the review aggregator. So it seems to be going down very well with critics, but I'm also seeing lots and lots of feedback from people watching it, saying they're really, really enjoying the show, just like myself and John are. But we have some feedback directly from our fellow warriors. First up, an email in from the wonderful Jimbo Oren. Great to hear from you again, Jimbo. Jimbo says, hi guys. Firstly, congratulations on the 10-year anniversary. Wow, that makes me feel old too. As an old Gothamite, it makes me feel even better that I managed to watch the first episode of Shogun last night so I can get back in touch to share my thoughts. I'm ashamed to admit that I owned the 80s show on DVD, but never actually got around to watching it. Hopefully not a cause for seppuku. Although I did read my dad's old copy of the book a long time ago and remember absolutely loving it, but also that it was hugely detailed and complex, so I could only recall odd moments. Having seen the trailer, I had high hopes for the series, and so far they have been absolutely blown away. I would actually go as far as to saying this is the most impressive opening episode episodes of any TV show I can remember, particularly the cinematography, which was absolutely stunning, rivaling epics like Lord of the Rings. The arrival to Osaka Castle was unbelievably filmed and made me wish I was watching this on a cinema screen with so much attention to detail and immaculate scene framing, even in shots lasting just a few seconds. The sound too was incredible, and I can't wait to get further into the story to see how they deal with things like big battle scenes. As for the story, I remember it takes a while to get into the politics and so on, but based on this episode, they will take their time to build up properly, as well as not shying away from some of the tougher scenes from the book either. I am also really glad they have characters actually speaking Japanese with subtitles, firstly to get away from everyone just speaking English, possibly with an awkward accent, but even more as it lets the show keep a bit more of its mystery. I really hope they can continue this level for the future episodes, and looking forward to watching along with you all again. Jimbo. Ah, great to hear from you, Jimbo. I want to say a huge thank you to you and to everybody who's shared their thoughts about our 10th anniversary, which just happened in the last couple of weeks. It's been really nice reconnecting with lots of our wonderful listeners who've been listening to us over those 10 years or joined us in the last year or joined us just for Shogun. It's been really nice hearing your thoughts and congratulations to us on our 10th anniversary. We're so delighted that we're covering Shogun as our 10th anniversary show. It's been really good so far. Lots and lots of great behind the scenes information out there, which kind of goes to some of the points you're making here, Jimbo. Things like the approach to the show that they wanted it to be in Japanese, wanted to make sure it was completely authentic to the Japanese experience, much more than they could possibly have done in the past. And part of that comes to the subtitles. The creators of the show knew the subtitles were going to be really important for the audience. They even framed the shots when they were filming, knowing that there was going to be subtitles on screen. So they made sure that how they'd framed the shots made the best use of the subtitles. That's fascinating to me. May not be fascinating to everybody, but I found that fascinating. But you may notice when you're watching the subtitles on this show versus other shows, they're a bit closer to the middle of the screen. And that was, again, another decision that they made to make sure that the audience could be involved in the show. You're not looking away to read the bottom line of the screen reading your subtitles. They're trying to make sure that you're able to take everything in, all the detail on screen, while also being able to read the extensive subtitles. Also on the writing, wow, this is a great story that the showrunners were talking about, where they wrote the original script, then sent it off to be translated. Then it was translated into more dialect from the 1600s. A scriptwriter looked at that and reworked it. Then it was translated back to English to make sure that the original showrunners were able to make any adjustments that they felt they needed to keep the drama in each of the situations. And then it was translated back into Japanese again for the actors to be able to interpret it on screen as well. And then they all worked together to adjust any lines that they felt would be out of place for the time. It's something like 7 translations for the script for the show, which is incredible to think how much was put into this, but really shows on screen that attention to detail, even just at the script stuff. Already talked about the detail behind the scenes and the costuming and the setup. The sets, everything is really, really detailed. This is a one-off, from my understanding. This is going to be the story of the Shogun book in one season of the show, so they are going to pour everything they can into it, which is great to see, and we are loving it so far. I'm really glad you are too, Jimbo. We also have some Facebook feedback. First up, we got some thoughts in from Jamie Lawton, who says, I also remember the 80s show with Richard Chamberlain. Living in Hong Kong at the time, I remember the books being almost required reading, especially Taipan and Noble House. I recently watched Noble House with Pierce Brosnan, and the showrunners, I believe, were the same as the original Shogun TV series, as well as same visuals. Also, few of the European actors showed up as well. I think Cosmo Jarvis is fantastic as Blackthorn, and a shout out to Batmanuel as Rodriguez. The show, even though a reboot, holds the interest of fans that they tell the story slightly differently and use different subplots from the book effectively to bring a fresh new aspect to the storytelling. Well, that's fascinating, Jamie. I actually never knew they did an adaptation of Noble House with Pierce Brosnan. That's interesting. I might have to seek that out once we're finished watching Shogun. And maybe that's an option for the showrunners of this show. Maybe they'll move on and adapt another one of James Clavell's series of books after they finish completing Shogun. Batmanuel as Rodriguez, for those of you unaware, the actor that plays Rodriguez in the show, Nestor Carbonell, played Batmanuel in The Tick. I probably know him much better for his work on Lost, because he was always good on Lost, but I did see every episode of The Tick too, so great to see him on there. Thanks for reminding me of that one, Jamie. Also over at Facebook, we had some feedback in from Adam Shimshak, who says, I spent my entire life not knowing being boiled alive like a lobster was an option of ways to die, but it may have raced to the top of the nope, don't want to die like that list. Totally agree with you, Adam. It's a brutal scene, and it's amazing with so much going on in the episode. I don't think we underlined as much how horrific that scene is. But it is. They certainly aren't avoiding doing those devastating things in the show to tone it down in any way. They're focusing on them as well. But really tough scene to watch. Also, Felipe Florencio gives his thoughts. He says, I am halfway through watching the first episode, and I'm massively disappointed that when they speak Portuguese, it's actually in English. If everyone needs to read the subtitles from the Japanese, why haven't they committed to Portuguese as well? It's like Scorsese's Silence all over again. But getting over this language barrier, I really enjoyed the episode. I look forward to the rest of the season. Thanks for your thoughts, Philippe. I, again, listening to the showrunners and some of the behind the scenes and on the official podcast, this was a choice that I made. They actually referenced Scorsese's Silence as well, which was a movie with Adam Driver and Andrew Garfield going to 15th century Japan. Where they had them speak in English instead of Portuguese. And I know, you know, it's one of those choices that they had to make. They said, you know, that 90% of the show was going to be in Japanese, and obviously it's a US production there, so they came up with this idea of Cosmo Jarvis as a British actor playing the role through English, but when he's speaking in English, he's actually speaking Portuguese. And interestingly, they also pointed out that when he's aboard ship with all of the crewmen, they're all Dutch, so he's actually, when he's speaking in English there, he's also speaking Dutch there. So he's speaking two languages through English. Pretty much they say it's because there would be no other opportunities for him to speak English because he's the only Englishman there, right? So that was the choice that they made. So they had their introductory character who's introducing the audience to Japan at the time is speaking in English, and everybody else is speaking in Japanese for the most part. So that was their decision that they made. And I guess, you know, if that comes from them making the show through a US production company. But hopefully, as you say, if you're able to get over that language barrier, you'll enjoy the rest of the season as much as you enjoyed that first episode. Also, over on Facebook, we got some feedback in from Dr. Bob Phillips, who says, scurvy, suicide, religious pillaging, slaughter of the innocents, lobster baths, showering in effluent, voyeurs, high politics, and pigeons. Can't say they skimped on anything in episode one, and crikey, what amazing scenery. Totally agree with you, Dr. Bob. It's just beautiful. Absolutely amazing to watch. Even, as I say, there are some really brutal moments in the episode as well, but it is amazingly shot scenery. Amazing to think it was filmed in British Columbia as well, in Canada, rather than being filmed in Japan, just because of COVID at the time. They couldn't move the production over to Japan, so decided to film it in Canada. So amazing that they've been able to pick up the scenery and make it look like 16th century Japan. Thanks, Dr. Bob. Also on Facebook, we got some feedback in from Victor Von Doom, who says, I really enjoy this story and the historical aspects of the time. The political intrigue is menacing. There are so many agendas cast against truths here. I look forward to Lord Taranaga getting his feet under him and exposing the council, Portuguese, and the church. I find this version of the story so much more intense than the original. Thanks, Victor. I really have been meaning to go and seek out the original and rewatch it. I watched a few clips a couple of weeks ago on YouTube just to kind of get a sense of how they were treating the characters in the show. But it's something that I think I'll go and watch in the future, but I'm really liking this version of it. This is a really contemporary version of a show based on 1600s Japan, of course, but it's great that they're able to have that view and have that accuracy of the experience of Japan on screen now with a huge budget behind it. It's great to see. As you say, yeah, the political intrigue in the show is one of the things that's most exciting and interesting to watch. So watch out for the next couple of weeks. It gets really, really intense. Thanks for that, Victor. Finally, we have some feedback in just on episode 2 from Jamie Lawton, who says, I find it interesting that they swapped Rodriguez from Portuguese to Spanish working for the Portuguese, when originally in the book he was Portuguese working for the Spanish. That's interesting, Jamie. Having not read the book, I wouldn't have known that. But it's a really interesting idea that it was very different in the book. Here, he also feels like an outsider. So he feels almost like someone that can be a confidant to John Blackthorne, but also they have a very uneasy alliance, as you see in the three episodes so far, where we've seen them deal with each other. So they're really, really good on screen together and swap their barbs against each other really, really well. But I wonder, would it have made it a bit more complicated if you introduced Spanish and Portuguese as two main groups here? We seem to be much more focused on the Portuguese in the show itself. But very interesting thoughts. Hopefully we'll get more of that from you as the season goes on as well. We'd love to hear the thoughts of anybody who's reading the books. Please send in the feedback that you have to feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com. And anybody else, if you want to send in any other feedback to keep me company while John's away for the next couple of weeks, you can also use that email address, feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com, of course, or you can pop on over to our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/TV Podcast Industries, where there's a spoiler post up for Shogun every week. I'll send you back over to John and myself to say goodbye for this episode of Shogun Chapter 3. We'll be back next Wednesday with our chat all about Shogun Chapter 4, The Eightfold Fence.
Very good.
I'm really looking forward to that one.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, thank you so much, fellow warriors, for joining us. Please share the podcast, because of course sharing the podcast is also sharing the love.
Sharing the love.
Yes. You can also head on over to patreon.com/TV Podcast Industries or buymeacoffee.com/TVPI, or head on over to our website where you can subscribe, rate us, leave a review of the podcast over on any good podcast catcher of your choice. But until chapter 4, keep watching and keep listening. Bye.
Bye.